Well, good morning, everybody. We're so glad that you're here. Thank you for coming. Welcome to IROC. We have an exciting day. We're very blessed and honored to be able to dedicate some children in the house today. And that's just incredible. Babies are the best, amen? And man, it just shows you that God still has a plan for this world, right? And so that's so good. We're very, very happy that you're here, and hopefully more are running in. I know the weather was crazy last night. Some power went out and with all that wind, but hopefully we will see everybody make it this morning. We want to invite you back this evening at 6. We always have a really, really great time on Sunday nights, and the Lord is moving, and we're thankful for that. We had a great time on Friday. And then we also want to make you aware of Tuesday morning prayer meeting. The ladies meet here in the other building from 9:30 to 11 on Tuesday mornings, and then our Thursday evenings at 6:30. And this week is our rest week for Friday Night Fire. So we will not be having service here Friday night. It will be the following. Right. But there is a Good Friday service at Novum Baptist Church in Madison, and we've been invited to be a part of that. So if you would like to join, we can give you directions or give you the address to that. So, all right, we're glad to be able to be here in the house of the Lord. Would you stand with me this morning? And we're just going to declare Psalm 91, and you'll see it on your screen, on the screen. And let's just declare this, and we just believe this word, and we claim it, and we hold on to it for our homes, for our church, for our workplaces, our schools, the area that we live in, our neighborhoods. We just declare Psalm 91. He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flies by day, nor for the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor for the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For He shall give His angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because He has set His love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Amen. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord Jesus, we are so blessed and honored and thankful and grateful to be in your house this morning. And Lord Jesus, we just want to set our minds and our attention and our focus on who you are. Lord, we want to let all the troubles, all the cares, the anxieties, the worries, Lord, that came in with us, we just want it to roll off, Lord. And we just want to put you first and love you most. And so, Lord, right now, I pray that you would captivate our gaze. Lord, that you would capture our attention. And Lord, that we would take these next few minutes and we would focus on the One. Lord, we would focus on the Lamb of God. Lord, that we would lift our eyes and we would look upon the beautiful One. Of who you are. Lord, there is no one better than you. And Jesus, Jesus, we just thank you. Lord, we pray let your glory and your presence just begin to fill this room. I pray the presence of the Holy Spirit just to rise up inside of us, God, that we would feel you, God. And Lord, we would know that you're moving in this room and you're ministering to our hearts, God. Lord, I speak to everyone who needs healing in Jesus' name, and we say be healed in the name of Jesus. And God, we pray that you would come, and Lord, that you would bring direction to those that need it, God. Lord, provide a map, Lord Jesus. Show them the way to go, God. Lord, we know that your word says that it's a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Lord, for those that need provision, I thank you that you are Jehovah Jireh and that you are coming to meet every financial need. I thank you, Jesus, that you are more than enough and that our God is able. And so, Lord, we take everything and we cast our cares at your feet. And we just want to take these next few minutes and focus on you. Lord, let the word come and let it challenge our hearts. And most of all, let it change us. We never want to be in your presence and not be changed. We thank you. We love you. We honor you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen, amen. Come on, church. Let's worship. Amen.
Oh, he's alive. everybody. God bless you. You can be seated for a moment. Good to have you in the house. Ushers are going to begin to serve you from the back to the front. Thank you in advance for your giving. How many think your front looks different, but you just can't figure it out? Front looks different? It's 16 more lights. And I looked at the video. It really made everything pop. So we praise God for that. And hallelujah. It was needed. So that's where part of your giving goes. But we're so glad you're here. If you're our guest today, welcome. We thank you for coming. You're only a guest one time. After that, you come back, we count you as home folk. Amen. So we're glad you're in the house. What a beautiful, beautiful Sunday morning. And this is the day the Lord has made. Hallelujah. And we will do what?
Thank you, Jesus.
Rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Thank the Lord. So we're looking forward to a great day. We've got four kids to dedicate this morning. Isn't that awesome? So if you're here and a part of that, amen, give the Lord a hand of praise. As I say, every little baby is God's way of saying he hasn't given up on humanity yet. And so we're glad for that. And we actually have one being dedicated a little bit later, and that's good too. How many know it's never too late until you're dead? You know, dedicate your life wholly to the Lord. Amen? Dedicate your life wholly to the Lord. And I believe it means something. And how many know when we give God something, he can keep it better than we can? I wish somebody would help me just a little bit. Let me say that again. When we give God something, he can keep it better than we can. Thank you, Lord. And so I'm so glad for that. I'm so glad that we have a faithful, faithful God that can meet our every need. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Bow your hearts with me. Father, we thank you today for your faithfulness to us. Lord, we praise you that you are a God that hears and answers prayer, and you provide and you make everything, Lord God, in its season and in its time, come forth to your plan and your purpose. And so, Lord, we commit this offering to you that it may accomplish that very purpose. And we give you praise in Jesus' mighty name. And everyone said, let's continue to worship.
To the King, he
Seated. We're so glad you're here. You know, when I look around and I see all kinds of folks represented, it makes me think that that's just a small microcosm of what heaven's going to look like. And I know around here we say IROC a lot, and we don't like say the whole name, but I want you to hear this. The name of our church is International Revival Outreach Center. How many know international means the whole world? If you've seen our church bus, it has a hand. It's pretty awesome. You really need to see it. The picture will just send chills down your spine. It's a big hand holding the whole world between the thumb and forefinger. And if you look over our doors, and we didn't just paint this in the last 24 hours for your benefit, it says, a local church with a global reach. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. How many glad he loved the whole world? Hallelujah. So if you're new to us, every once in a while, we just need to explain what the name of our church is, what we're about. And prior to becoming pastor, I traveled in some 33 different countries of the world. Built churches in many countries, preached in many places. And in fact, I've preached a lot through interpreter, and we used to call them interrupters, because you'd preach and then they'd interrupt and then you'd preach. And so in Spanish, there's interruptar. Yeah. So, but I heard so many prayers at the end for salvation that I pretty well memorized it in Spanish. And I know whenever I do this, I'm like, uh-oh, dear Jesus, please help me that I don't blow it, because I know I can butcher things sometimes. But it goes like this: Señor, perdóname todos mis pecados. Escribe mi nombre en el libro de vida. Limpia me en el sangre de Jesús. Does that sound right? Yeah. Hallelujah. So you that didn't have a clue what I just said, dear Lord, forgive me of all of my sins. Write my name in the book of life. Wash me in your blood. Hallelujah. Oh, I feel God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So I got to tell you this neat story real quick. How many know that the devil doesn't have a corner on drunks? How many know there's drunks in every country? Okay, so this is not a slam to anybody. But I happened to be in Chile. It was our day off. We'd been preaching every night and building a church. And there was a big entourage of us just walking down the street. And this drunk Chilean made a beeline for me. I don't know what the attraction was. I think it was just a devil magnet in him trying to agitate whatever in me, which is the Lord. But it was pretty humorous because of all the guys that were walking down the street, none of them knew Spanish, and I knew enough to be dangerous. And why do I know enough to be dangerous? Because I know the sinner's prayer. He came up to me and he started saying gringo this and gringo that, and I could tell he wasn't happy with me, and I'm not sure what some of the words he said I'd never heard before, and I'm sure they weren't complimentary. Okay? But I said this. I could have said, vamos, ahora mismo. You know, I could have said, cierra la boca, ahora mismo. You know, like, get out of here. Shut your mouth right now. Okay, I didn't know that much, but I did. I looked at him. I said, Cristo te llama. Jesus loves you. I promise you before God, when I said that the third time, tears started streaming down his face. I said, oremos, let's pray. I led him in the sinner's prayer. And then he said, ¿Dónde está su iglesia? Where is your church? And I went on my way rejoicing, and he like sobered up right in front of my eyes. I'm telling you, there's a power in the gospel. Thank you, Jesus. I said, there's a power in the gospel. Now, I have to check with my friends. Did I do okay? Did it? Yep. Thank you. Thank you. Muchas gracias. So, hallelujah. Anyway. Somebody said I have a Castilian accent when I speak Spanish, and that's because I did spend a lot of time in Chile. We built a lot of churches and stayed there weeks on end sometimes. And right before I got ready to go home, I was starting to get pretty proficient. But having said all that, let me say we are so glad you're here today. Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask every family that's dedicating a child to the Lord, will you come forward right now, please? And anybody that you've asked to come forward with you, that's fine too. We got a big front down here. All I'm asking is please watch the change in elevation, the steps. If there's a change in the color carpet, there's a change in your elevation, okay? If you're not new here, it's amphitheater. My dad was kind of forward thinking. You know, when he built this 40 plus years ago, amphitheater was not everybody's thing they were doing. So, but thank God. If you folks would turn and face me, please. Just come across here, parents, right across here. And everybody else, turn around and face me, if you will. Parents all the way across here. All the way. Hallelujah. All right, look at me just like you're getting ready to get married, okay? Now come right on over. Fill right in, please. Okay, and you guys can stand with whoever you need to stand with. And it just dawned on me that, hallelujah, what a joyous occasion. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And hallelujah. Hon, I'm going to ask you to run to my office and get those baby Bibles off of my desk, okay? And I know you'll be back before I'm done. Thank you, Lord. Now, I've got to thinking about this. And it's been a long time since I've held tiny ones, okay? And I think I can make the transfer okay. But I think today, if it's okay, I know Jesus took them up in his arms and blessed them. But I think today I'm just going to walk over and bless them in your arms. Is that okay? And you know, thank God, never dropped a baby in my life, never drowned nobody baptizing, and today won't be the first. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. We're so glad you're here. What a wonderful, joyous occasion this is, but it's also very solemn. Let me charge every parent here for a moment, and I'm going to read an exhortation to you in a moment and have you make a commitment. But the most important job you'll ever have on this planet is not the job you make money at. It's the job you have that you're holding in your arms and is standing in front of you. And that job is that you raise them for heaven. Hey, buddy. That's my buddy. He's always reaching for me. That touches my heart, man. All right. I'll take care of you later, bud. Okay. I'm going to stand this way. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I know I could say something right now and it would sound self-serving, but I'm going to tell you something. Kids are a judge of character. If you're mean, they'll stay away from you. But that does just fit right into what Jesus said. You know, people brought their kids to him to bless, and the disciples said, no, don't bother me. What did he say? He said, suffer the little children, let them come unto me, and in no wise turn them away, for such is the kingdom of God. And then it says, then he took them up in his arms and blessed him. So I just want you to know, little kids love Jesus. Amen. And I would just say, little kids know when you love Jesus. Hallelujah. Having said that, awesome. Let me just give you that verse that we just referred to. Actually, it's a two-verse passage. Then were there brought unto him little children that he should put his hands on them and pray. And the disciples rebuked them, but Jesus said, suffer the little children and forbid them not to come unto me, for of such is the kingdom of heaven. And he laid his hands on them and departed thence. Now, I'm relieved that I picked this passage, because here it doesn't say he took them up in his arms. It says he just laid his hands on them. So I'm going to go with what Jesus did in this. Hallelujah. All right, here we go. The family is a divine institution ordained of God from the beginning of time. Children are a heritage of the Lord committed by him to their parents for care, protection, and training for his glory. It is meet or necessary that all parents recognize this obligation and their responsibility to God in this matter. Jochebed of old trained her own child, Moses, after having given him to the Lord. Hannah recognized that her child was Jehovah's. The Virgin Mary also brought the infant Jesus to the temple. The parents of this child likewise recognize the sacredness of their charge and now bring back to the Lord the treasure with which the Lord has entrusted them. In so doing, they recognize and hereby publicly acknowledge their responsibility for the nurture and admonition of this child in the ways of righteousness and godliness. So I'm going to read a charge to you. And Mom and Dad, I'm just going to ask you to say out loud, with God's help, we will. Because how many know you can't do it without his help? Amen. So for Lenora and Landon and Gideon and Tegan, hallelujah. What a wonderful day this is. You know, this may be a record. I don't know if we've ever had four at one time. One record we set is we dedicated a baby, performed a wedding ceremony, and took somebody into the church and membership, and I still preached all in one Sunday. And we were done by 12:15. That was a miracle. But we're not trying to rush through something. This is sacred. But I want to charge you right now. I give you this charge before God. In the sight of the Lord and in the presence of these witnesses, do you solemnly undertake to bring up this child in the fear and admonition of the Lord? If so, will you say, with God's help, we will. Do you promise early to seek to lead them to accept Jesus Christ as their Savior and Lord? Do you promise as far as it lies in you to set before them an example of godly and consistent lives? Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Can you give me that Bible for Lenora? I'm going to just start down on that end. And this is Lenora Grace Williamson. I'm going to give that to Mama. And I want to, Lord Jesus, we dedicate little Lenora to you, to your glory, and to your honor. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful gift, and we thank you for James and Shannon. And Lord, I thank you that you've blessed them with this awesome, beautiful gift. And Lord, I pray all the days of her life she will be protected and covered, and that the angel that's been assigned to her would always behold the face of her Heavenly Father as he goes about his duties. For Lord, your word says the angels of the Lord are camping around about them that fear them and deliver them. We bless them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Now for Landon. Landon Juanito Cash. I'm going to give that to you, son. This is Gideon. Awesome. Thank you, Lord. Brother, I don't want to butcher your last name.
Belarger.
All right. As fast as you said that, I'm just going to say, okay. I want to bless you, son. Father, I thank you for Landon. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you will watch over him, and the angel that always beholds the face of his heavenly Father will go before and behind him and surround him and protect him and cover him. And Lord, that he will walk with you, and that he will establish a relationship with you, that he will grow up to be an awesome young man for the glory of God. Father, I lay hands on Gideon. I thank you for this wonderful gift of life. And Lord, I thank you that the angel of the Lord that always beholds the face of his heavenly Father will go before and behind and protect and lead and guide. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. All right, where's my buddy? Hallelujah. Tegan William Mills, I'm going to give that to you, Dad. Hey, buddy. Jesus, I thank you for Tegan. Lord, I praise you for his life. I thank you for what a testimony and for what an answer to prayer. Lord, thank you for your presence, Lord. God, I pray this moment will ever be cemented into our spirits that, Lord, you are a God that hears and answers. Even if it's not always on our time frame or in our way, you always answer. And I thank you, Lord God. Now I bless Tegan. And Lord, I pray that all his days, the angel that beholds the face of his heavenly Father will go before and behind, protect and guide and direct. And Lord, that he will grow up to be an awesome young man that loves you with all of his heart. And we'll give you praise in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Can we just give the Lord a big hand of praise? Thank you. Thank you, guys. Praise the Lord. God bless you so much. Y'all may be seated. Watch the return trip, if you will. Just watch the step-ups. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Isn't that awesome? Amen. Thank God. Thank God for his goodness. Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's worship. Hallelujah. This song goes with the rest of the dedication.
Lord bless you. Thank you. children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you in a thousand generations, in your family, in your children, in their children.
God bless you. You may be seated. Amen. Give Jesus a hand. Thank you, worship team. God bless you. We're so glad you're in the house today. Welcome again to all of you that have come. And wow, it is amazing. Time is flying. It's hard to believe. Next Sunday is Easter. Wow. So today is Palm Sunday. Now, I may not preach a traditional Palm Sunday message, but there's nothing that says thou shalt preach a Palm Sunday message on Palm Sunday. I try to follow the leading of the Lord, but we're going to give honorable mention to Palm Sunday today. But, you know, some of these events on our calendar, there's only so many ways you can say the same thing. And so we may branch out and we might look at things from a little bit different perspective today, but I think you'll see how well it ties in when we're done. But let me just say something real quick that I don't take a lot of time, just like I didn't take a lot of time. In fact, I can't remember the last time I really took any time to explain our church name, but we're constantly being... we're constantly having new folks, new guests, new people that don't know everything about us. And so for that sake, we need to explain some things every once in a while. But we're also, through our ministry that we had for 32 years before we came here to be pastor, we've been feeding kids in Mozambique, Africa. And for a while, it was Calcutta, India, as well as Mozambique, Africa. And the church so graciously took over a very large portion of our feeding program when we came here because we were on the road full time, so we didn't have the means wherewithal to keep that going. But let me just say, if you would like to give to anything like that, please let us know, because over the years... we have found reputable people that we can partner with, that your gift is maximized to its fullest potential. Like the reason we worked with Mission of Mercy and still do, it used to be called Calcutta Mission of Mercy, and then they changed the name after Mark Buntain passed to Mission of Mercy because their focus became more than just the country of India. But let me tell you something that's amazing about Mission of Mercy. Mission of Mercy has a group of business folks by the name of the Bethesda Corporation, and they underwrite all the admin expenses of Mission of Mercy, so 100% of what you give goes to the need. How many think that's pretty awesome? Now, you know, I could name some secular charities right now, and I'm not going to do it, but if you look at their track record, sometimes only 30 to 40% of what you give actually makes it to the real need. The rest of it is just chewed up and to me, that's unconscionable, okay? Obviously, there has to be something. You can't keep the doors open, the lights on, and run off of nothing. But a good charity, I'll just give you a rule of thumb. A good charity is somewhere around 90 to 94% is about where they're falling in as to what it actually makes it, and only about 6 to 7% of it is anything to do with administrative cost. That's a good charity, okay? So I just want you to know. But when you can find someone 100%, you can't get better than 100%. And so also when we give to Iris Ministries, which is Roland and Heidi Baker. Many of you probably don't know this, and I don't know if I've ever gave this explanation, and never on Sunday morning that I can remember, but Mozambique, Africa was 50 years behind the rest of the what you would call civilized world. And by civilized world, meaning lights, electricity, running water, etc., certain basic standards of life and living. Then they were hit with a countrywide flood. I don't know if you remember this. Several years ago, there was a lady in Mozambique that actually gave birth to a baby in a tree, and mama and baby both lived. I want you to let that sink in for a moment, ladies. To think you could keep your presence of mind about you in a tree, in raging floodwaters, deliver a baby, and the baby and you both live. Somebody, yeah, that's a wowzer. That's beyond. But I say that to say this, that flood set them back another 50 years. So they were 100 years behind the rest of the developed world. And so we try to look for places where there's a real need. And so we've continued that through our ministry, SMEA. We've continued to feed kids in Mozambique, Africa. And we go back partnering with Mission of Mercy clear back to like 1980. And so, you know, you really don't know everything if you just come and sit. And if we never tell you, you never know. And, you know, you're always like, there's always this like, fine tightrope. If you tell folks, it can sound to some like you're trying to brag, but if you don't tell them, they never know. And how many know we need to know? We need to know. So I would just say to those that love me, you won't interpret it that way. To those that don't, the Lord bless you anyway. And He'll deal with you. Okay? So I just know this. We are so blessed to live in a country where we can send more than we need to someone else who doesn't have enough. And that's why it's more blessed to give than to receive. Amen? So, just because we don't talk about that all the time doesn't mean we're not doing it. And we're supporting numerous missionaries around the world. And so if you want more information about who we're supporting, you can look at some certificates on the hallways on both sides, or you can just have a chat with our mission secretary, Sister Carol. Wave at everybody. You track her down, and I promise you, she will talk to you about missions as long as you want to listen. Because that's her heart, okay? And by the way, Miss Carol, that's a compliment, okay? Look, nothing succeeds if the person leading it isn't passionate about what they do. And you know, so sad is that so many people do not understand the difference between passion and intensity and whatever else they want to call it, okay? I get passionate and intense when I preach. But, you know, to folks that don't know me, they may think I'm getting mad. No, I'm not mad. But there are times when I preach, I get mad at the devil. Anybody know what I'm talking about? How many of you ever got mad at the devil? If you don't get mad at the devil, there's something wrong with you. You need to get saved, and then you will get mad at the devil. Because he's been mad at you for a long time. Amen? So I would submit that you reciprocate the madness when it comes to the devil. Amen? By the way, you know, we don't hate. We don't teach people to hate. But I want to bless you to hate the devil. I want to bless you to hate the devil and everything about him. Amen? Fair enough? Praise the Lord. So I want to talk a little bit before we actually get to a text address this morning. So, you know, don't think that we're not using the Bible. Just stay tuned, okay? And we're going to arrive at our thematic text today, because not just one particular scripture, but to kind of assuage people's anxiety who feel like the sermon hasn't started yet, if you haven't given a text right up front, let me go ahead and just give you one that we'll refer to later. Proverbs 14:12 says this. I want you to hear this, because this is very powerful. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Let that sink in for a minute. There is a way that seems right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. How many know you better have something beside your opinion to back up what you believe? Because there's a heaven to gain and there's a hell to shun. And when you close your eyes in death, you will end up in one or two places. And you can say, well, I don't believe that. You know, I'm just here. I'm just making an obligatory appearance. Well, God bless you. We're glad you're here anyway. But I can just tell you, there is far, far too much evidence otherwise for you to hold on to that view. There's, if you want to just look up some books, they're no longer in print, but you can probably even order one off of Amazon or whatever, and I'm not trying to endorse any company, corporation, or whatever, so please don't come to me and tell me all the evils of Amazon. I'm just telling you where you might be able to find something. Fair enough? I mean, it takes so much longer to preach nowadays because you got to do all these disclaimers, okay? But there's a book called Beyond Death's Door, written by a doctor. I have the copy, and I cannot lend it out. I'm sorry. I've learned the hard way. I lend out books. They don't make it back, and everybody and their mama's like, Pastor, I'll bring it back, and I know they mean well, and then something happens, and it don't come back. So before you be offended by that, let me just say to every tradesman in here, you don't lend your tools to every Tom, Dick, and Harry all over the country. I know you don't, so let's just all say yes. Okay, but it's written by a doctor, and he actually gives accounts of people who actually died on the operating table, died in his office, went to hell, came back. One man he was working on had a heart attack in the waiting room. He rushed out into the waiting room, began to beat on the man's chest. Got him resuscitated. He came back when his eyes fluttered back open. He grabbed the doctor like a drowning man with his lapels. He had his white doctor's coat on. He pulled him down into his face, and with clenched teeth, barely being able to talk, he said, please don't stop working on me. Every time you do, I go back to hell. You say, Pastor, you're trying to scare me. Well, you know, I would say if you're an intelligent human being, it ought to scare the bejabbers out of you to think about being lost forever. I would say if you have an ounce of intelligence, that ought to, yeah. And the Bible talks about in the book of Jude that we save some by fear as brands plucked out of the burning. So if that's what it takes to get you there, I don't think anybody's going to come up to me in heaven and say, "You scared the fire out of me when you preached, and I'm just, I'd have been wanting to catch up with you ever since to tell you how offended I am." But isn't heaven great? I just don't think that's going to happen. And you know, you may think you're too superior intellectual whatever to believe in a hereafter. But let me just quote a little bit from a previous message. It takes far less faith to believe what I believe. Because if you believe evolutionary nonsense, you believe from goo to you by the way of the zoo. From a ray of light to a tadpole. From a tadpole to a possum. And there's all these quantum leaps and fossil gaps, but don't let that bother you, because anytime we have a gap, we just say there was a quantum leap, it happened too fast to make a fossil. And then we say the reason we don't see any signs of evolution today is because it happens too slow. And see, if evolution was still going on, somebody ought to be coming out of the jungle somewhere that's just now making the transition from monkey to human and say, "Excuse me, can you tell me where I can find a suit of clothes?" And we have none of that. And we have 5,000 years of recorded history. So, I mean, you know, it can't just be that slow, okay? And then we have things frozen in ice, and we have the piltdown man, and we have chicken bones and things put together, and we have all of this stuff. And to believe somehow that we could have this gigantic explosion and everything could swirl around the atmosphere and just end up at the precise place to sustain life, and the earth just happened to be on a 23-degree tilt and just happened to be spinning at 1,000 miles an hour, and we have seasons and day and night and all of that because it does, and we're just far enough away from the sun not to burn up or freeze to death, and the moon just happens to be at the right distance to have tides so everything in the ocean continues to live because the tides are the made of the ocean, and it all just happened, and you're an intelligent thinking person, and you know nobody that's ever created anything out of nothing, and the clothes you had just didn't happen. They didn't filter down out of outer space. They have designer labels on them. The car you drive is not as a result as an explosion from Detroit, although you may think sometimes it runs like that. Everything that with a design has a designer. Everything that has a plan has a planner. Everything you and I see first took place in somebody's mind as a concept. And then it made it to a drawing board. Then it made it to an architecture firm. Then it made it to a lot of banks while people wring their hands and hope they get the capital to put together what they wanted. But the God of all the universe just spoke. I wish somebody'd shout on that. I said the God of all the universe just spoke. And so scientists say there was a big bang. Well, Psalms tells me he uttered his voice and it thundered. I don't have any problem with your big bang. I just have a problem with what you think happened after it. Now listen, you can say, well, you know, Pastor knew I was coming. He set me up. Can I just tell you, to all of our guests, you are so welcome today. We love you. And I promise you, not one of your family members came to me and said, "Preach this, preach that, preach the other. They're coming. Preach this, preach that. Tell them this, tell them that, tell them the other." I got zero texts from anyone trying to load my gun. Just disclaimer so everybody can rest, because, you know, because I've had folks invite people, and then the folks invite them come to me and they're like, "Pastor, I just, like, you was nailing it right down the line. I mean, right between the eyes. I know they think we talked. I know they think." So I want to, let's ease everybody. Nobody talked. There's a God in heaven and he knows who you are. And I've seen it happen too many times. This is not my first rodeo. I'll be at this 47 years next month. Seen it happen over and over again. I mean, sometimes just falling down funny. It's so precise. Like, I remember, you know, one time I got on, like, alcohol, drinking, you know, drunkenness, and I said, "You wonder why you can't get free." And I said, "Your living room is decorated with little bottles of every sample of whiskey known to man in your living room on a shelf." guy came to him after service. He said, Brother Steve, he said, I don't know what I'm going to do. He said, man, he said, we're in trouble. He said, I invited my brother to come to revival tonight, and he works at, and he named the name of the airport, and he said all of those airlines have given him complimentary little liquor bottles, and he's took them home and built shelf in his living room, and he's got every one of them brands on a shelf in his living room around. And I guess you think that's just an accident. I guess you think that's just... I'm going to tell you something. If you have accidents like that, I don't even play the lottery and I don't recommend you to. But if you have accidents like that, probably somehow ought to be playing it so we can like finance the kingdom. Because that's pretty precise. How many think that's pretty precise? Because I've never been in anybody's house that had a living room like that. Uh-oh. So, oh, pastor's at it again. Well, no, the Holy Ghost is at it again. He never misses. He never misses. I walk away some nights after preaching and somebody will say, so-and-so, I'll say, I didn't know any of that. You know, hey, thank God he lives. And he wants a relationship with you. Even though you spent a big part of your life ignoring him, he still wants a relationship with you. What an awesome God. Because I know how human beings are. You don't want anything to do with me, I don't want anything to do with you. Just go somewhere. Wow. And you know, when I say go somewhere, you know what everybody likes to say. So why do you keep telling people to go to a place that you declare don't exist? I mean, that's a valid question. I wish somebody helped me just a little bit. That's a valid question. You need to stop that mess. And when somebody tells me not, no, I don't think so. I meant Jesus. And he canceled my trip to hell. I wish somebody helped me. Oh, hallelujah. He canceled my trip and I don't have to go. And I'm not going to take your suggestion. Ain't we having fun? I ain't got in it yet. I'm just like, this is the preamble. This is the introduction. But I'm going somewhere. I want you to hear me. Because here's the thing about it. Do you know... And I'm pulling these statistics off the top of my head, so I'll tell you right up front, I could be off by just a little bit. So I'm going to round it down with a, if you know something about me, I'll lowball things so I don't get accused of exaggerating, okay? I think it's about 90, 94%, but I'm going to say 90% of everyone living for Jesus got saved before their 20th birthday. How many know people are like concrete, thoroughly mixed up and set in their ways? And the older they get, the harder they become. Did you know the Hoover Dam is still curing? The concrete in the Hoover Dam is still curing. Remember that again. That's a good one. That's worth the price of admission today, although you weren't charged. People are like concrete, thoroughly mixed up and set in their ways. How many have tried to break up concrete? You say, Pastor, what a challenge you have. Yeah, because after you pass 20, if you haven't accepted the Lord as your Savior, the numbers start going down. By the time you reach 75, it's one in a 700,000 plus chance you will ever bow your knee and admit you need a Savior. That's frightening. And can I tell you, it is so dangerous just to go around saying, all my life. Now, you may hear me from time to time say, you know, I'm 65 and I'm not going to change now. But let me tell you why I say that. Because how many know if you're on course, you don't need to change course, you just need to stay the course. I'm not telling you that I'm not open to change if there's some area where I need to change, but I'm telling you I've been reading the same book and it don't change. And so if I'm going to be faithful to the same book, I'm not going to change. Did everybody get that? And guess what? I'm in real good company because Jesus, it says Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. He don't change. How many are glad he don't? The book of Malachi tells us, I'm the Lord God. I change not. Therefore, you sons of Jacob are not consumed. How many are glad that God don't wake up in a bad mood? How many know you don't know what you're going to get when you're around some people? It's like a box of chocolates. Are you with me? How many know it's true? We got in a red hot revival. Lasted for 19 weeks. A lady got gloriously touched by God in that revival. She told on herself, okay? So I'm not speaking out of school. I'm not going to give you her name anyway. But she told on herself. We didn't tell this. She told it. She stood up and she testified and she said, I was destroying my family with my tongue. She said, I would constantly tell my husband, I make more money than you. I'm more intelligent than you. I'm more educated than you. She said, I so browbeat him down to where he laid on the couch in a fetal position and would no longer even try. She said, I was so irritable that my oldest daughter would send the little one down the hallway to the kitchen to see what kind of mood I was in before the rest of the kids made it to the kitchen. And she said, I've got to go home and undo all the damage I've done and begin to build up what I've tore down. And I repent before God. Whew. Wow. Man, I just felt the presence of God just... That's a conviction word right now. Can I tell you, it's not a bad thing to be convicted. In fact, it's really a good thing. I know you may feel uncomfortable for the moment, but can I tell you this? Whenever you come to church and a preacher preaches and steps on your proverbial toes, it means God loves you so much he don't want you to be destroyed. And there's over 7 billion people on the planet, and he would care enough to, like, speak to you? And you would get offended about that? How many think that'd be pretty dumb? So even if you got stepped on from your toes clear up to your nose today, I'd leave walking to the parking lot saying, wow, God really does care. Because how many know if he didn't care, he'd never say anything to you, never speak to you, never convict you, just ignore you, and you'd be destroyed. But he speaks to us and convicts us by his Spirit that we might have an opportunity to change so we can get on the right course. So when I say that, I'm saying when, lo, those 47 years next month when I accepted Christ as my Savior, I'm not deviating from that. I intend with the help and grace of God to finish strong and finish on course. How many will help me get there? All 3 of you. Oh, thank you, thank you. Thank you. You know, but it took you a second. That's okay. I'm having fun with you. But it dawned on you what I meant. By help me get there, it meant you're going to pray for me. Because that's what I was asking. Amen? I know you can't physically push me along. However, every once in a while, my wife and I will go out for a walk, and not so much anymore because I'm not having as the same difficulty. I don't mean we don't still walk. I mean, just hold on, baby. It's going to turn out good. It might make you look good. But we'll go for a walk, and I'd start getting a little winded going up a grade, and all of a sudden I'd feel this little hand come up in the middle of my back and just start pushing me up the hill, and I'm like, oh, that feels pretty good. I'm like, how many every once in a while we can use one of them pushes? But your push to your pastor in the small of his back is your prayer. Amen. So, what have you believed all your life that just isn't true? What are you currently doing because of those beliefs that just isn't working? And do you have the courage to change your belief system once you've been told the truth? Can I just ask you a question? Have you ever been talking to someone and all of a sudden they said something really profound and you said, wow, I never thought of it that way before? Anybody ever had that? How many know if that really made an impact on you and it was a revelation? How many think you shouldn't forget that or just revert back to the opinion you had that now this proves the opinion was wrong? See, a wise man listens to truth and then adjusts his course accordingly. You know, one of the most horrific all-time maritime disasters is the Titanic. I've read about the Titanic. I've been to exhibit about the Titanic. I know a little bit about the Titanic. I'm not going to try to tell you I'm an authority on the Titanic, but I can tell you this. The company that designed it, the man made a very foolish statement. He said, this ship is so safe, even God himself couldn't sink it. On the day of the maiden voyage, a 12-year-old girl turned to her daddy. Now, you got to understand, 12-year-old girls back in that time were probably like equivalent to 25 now, probably, just because of the level of education and the grammar they were exposed to, et cetera, et cetera. And she said, Father, she said, I feel like we are flying into the very jaws or face of disaster. At 12 years old, the Holy Spirit had given her a premonition about the upcoming voyage. There was a signal sent in to the Titanic. Caution, ice flows ahead. Caution, ice flows ahead. Caution, ice flows ahead. Flows in FLOES, which is mean floating icebergs. The guy was arranging for his uber-rich guest on board connections in New York City, what limo was going to pick them up, what time, expected arrival, etc., port of call, everything and all of that. And he replied back to those trying to warn, shut up, you're jamming my signals. They hit the ice field at full speed. It peeled the side of the ship open like somebody opening a can of sardines. And suddenly the dance music changed to the band playing, Near My God to Thee. As people begin to slip into the icy darkness of a watery grave. All my life. What are you willing to change when you finally hear something that refutes you had the wrong idea? Only pride and arrogance would cause you to continue to think of it the same way. This is Palm Sunday. And this message is right on point because I want you to listen to this. The main reason Jesus was rejected is he did not live up to their expectations of what a Messiah was supposed to be. They were looking for him to come as conquering king, but he came the first time as suffering servant. Now we've got a world upside down that's gone into snowflake mode. Everybody's feelings gets hurt at the drop of a hat. And he's not coming back as suffering servant. He's coming back as roaring lion. You better get this thing straight. They messed it up the first time because they were looking for a deliverer from Rome. They were looking for a physical salvation, and he was bringing a spiritual salvation. But this next time, he's not coming back to be spat upon, ostracized, beat with a cat of nine tails, and spiked to a tree. He's coming back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords with fire in his eyes. And he's going to rule and reign. And so this suffering, lowly, meek servant, humble and lowly, meek and mild Jesus that you just lockstepped in with, and that's all you can think of. I want you to understand he does have another side. And this world is going to see it very soon. And I got to give a shout out. I'm not a basketball fan. I really don't care for basketball. I didn't have the height for it. I just really never liked it. Okay. That's just me. Aren't you glad everybody don't like the same thing? There'd be a shortage. You couldn't get in sideways. That's just me, okay? My sport was baseball. But there's a young man who this video feed just popped up on my phone by the name of Jaden Ivey, I believe. Am I saying that right? Plays for the Detroit Pistons. He's given a post-game interview. And he says, I just want everybody to know Jesus is coming soon. And we all need to repent of our sins and get ready. And I'm like, whoa. And so I just became a fan of Jaden Ivey. I ain't never watched a Detroit Pistons game. But that's a young man that deserves a shout out. May God increase his tribe and bless him with his boldness. I was like, you need to Google that. If you can't find it, say, Pastor, I'll send it to you. Dropped in my phone. And that wasn't all he said. He told him before that, he said, I just want to, thank my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for giving me the opportunity. And then at the end, man, I thought the dude's already done preached here now. But then he like dropped a big one. Wow. What? Look, you cannot afford to like be at the end of your life and say, well, all my life, I've thought all my life, and then realize you're going into eternity and it's all wrong. I told him, it's either Friday night or Thursday night. I think it was Thursday night Bible study. Anton LaVey, the leader of the Satanist church who wrote the Satanic Bible, on his deathbed, he's saying, what have I done? What have I done? What have I done? Something is very wrong. Something is very wrong. Something is very wrong. He went out into eternity saying something is very wrong. The devil he had worshipped deceived his soul, and now he's damned for eternity. You can't wait until it's over before you find out you're wrong. Somebody needs to humble themselves and say, all my life I thought it was this way. Now I know it's not. Jesus, have mercy on me. I repent. I want to come your way. That's just smart. Why bother to ask directions? Man, I'm going to tell you something. I've traveled. Some of the directions, I'm going to tell you, it's a trip. Oh, my. We're talking about before the days of cell phones, okay? And I'm going to preaching. Pastor says, there's this lady in church, she's got an empty apartment. You're going to be there for the weekend, you and your wife. It's nice. You'll like it. And just call her for directions. So I call up this lady. She says, well, she said, I live down this road. And said, you turn by this great big tree. And said, you come down a few houses. And she said, I'll be sitting on the porch in a blue dress. Well, we drove. We found a big tree. At least seemed like a big tree. Went down, didn't see nobody on the porch in a blue dress. Rode around the block a couple times, kept rehashing what she told us. There was a woman on the porch, but she had on a green dress. I ain't colorblind. And so I finally pulled in the driveway because I didn't know what else to do. She said, oh, yeah. She said, I got hot. I went inside and changed. I wanted to lay hands on her. Without the oil. I didn't, but how many think you'd be a smite bit irritated? And we'd only drove 4 hours. You don't want to get it to end and somebody's changed dresses on you. Can I get a witness? I'm telling you, folks, I love you. I love you enough to tell you the truth. That was a trip, wasn't it? We walked in that apartment. As soon as the door closed, she was out of earshot. It was unbelievable, unbelievable. I just like, oh, wow. I was on a motorcycle trip. A friend of mine, we stopped this little country store to ask for some directions. Sweet little young lady behind the counter, I don't know, 18, 19 years old, just a kid. We asked her directions, and she didn't know anything. She didn't even suspect anything. And we walked out, and I'm not trying to diss him. I'm just telling you, this is what happened. And we looked at each other, and I told my friend, I said, I don't think she's ever been out to county. And that's okay. Not everybody's world travel. I'm not putting nobody down. I'm just saying, if you're going to ask directions, you need to ask directions from somebody who's been there. Somebody at least knows what is north and south and east and west, and turn it to Big Tree, and I'll be in a blue dress. And I mean, we're talking about eternity here. How many think you better get a little more a little more specificity, please, Pastor? Yeah. So he was rejected because the first time he came, a suffering servant, Lamb of God, and they were looking for conquering king. All their lives, they had been looking for deliverance from their enemy, Rome. So what happened? The shouts of hail, hail, hail at the beginning of the week turned to nail, nail, nail by the end of the week. That's how fickle the crowd is. So maybe we better all just stop worrying too much about what other people think. And maybe we better just make sure we've got this thing straight. And maybe we better just be humble enough to say, you know, all my life I've just like been looking at things pretty much the wrong way. And this is an aha moment. This is a come to Jesus moment. This is a revelation moment. And I'm going to humble myself and receive that moment because God is good enough to speak to me. While we're on deathbeds and we're talking about the reality of places, I won't go into all the detail because I know you've heard, especially the home crowd, but there's a lot of people here today that haven't. But when my daddy passed away and there was tubes running down his throat, couldn't speak, you could see the blood coming out, pumping out of his lung, head nurse turned to me and said 20% of his heart's working. He's on no pain meds because if we give him anything, it'll slow his heart down, and his heart is barely beating now. They beat on his chest to resuscitate him, busted his ribs. His ribs had punctured his lung. He was laying there dying. He wrote on a paper to me, legal pad, is it suicide to want these tubes out? I said, absolutely not, Dad. You've lived a good life. You don't have to lay here and suffer. You're ready to go. He wrote, praise the Lord, and underlined it about four times. Then he drew a big heart on this yellow legal pad, and he pointed to my mama. And then he wrote the words, I'll never forget if I live to be 500 on this planet. He wrote, I feel the hands of God lifting me. And in 45 minutes, every machine was turned off and unplugged, and he slipped out of the ether waves of this realm into the arms of his Savior. And I can't change course now because I want to see him again. I don't need to change course because I'm on the right course. Yeah. And then my mama. Yeah, I know. Just bear with me. Give me a little. It's okay. I know you've heard it before, but others have it. You need to hear it. My mama hasn't spoken to anybody for 2 weeks. She's dying of Alzheimer's. She's laying flat on her back, bedridden. I'm sitting there by her bed, holding her hand. I prayed for her. I went to pull my hand away. She clamped down on my hand. It felt like an iron vice. I couldn't believe it. Where did the strength come from, this lady? And all of a sudden, I heard her whisper the name of Jesus. There were days she didn't even know the name of her own son, but Alzheimer's could not steal the name of Jesus. I still don't know how she did this, because you try it. You're in good shape. You try it. You go home, lay on your back, and with no supporting help from your arms, set straight up. Come back and tell me how it worked. She sat bolt right up in bed and said, hallelujah, glory to God. I said, I love you, Mom. She said, I love you more. Right back on the pillow, eyes closed, and that was all she ever said. In just a little while, she was in eternity. I can't wait till, well, all my life I've thought it this way. All my life I've believed it this way. All my life. Can I tell you this? The epitome of arrogance and pride is to be confronted with truth that proves what you believe is to be wrong, and you refuse to change your beliefs and just keep sailing on into destruction. Shut up, you're jamming my signals. Shut up about that talk about eternity, Pastor. You're slowing my roll. You're messing with my party. Yeah, and all of the arrogant, blasphemous talk, I got to deal with the devil selling iced tea and beer at the horse races. Let me just give you my classic line on that. All parties in hell have been canceled due to a big fire. You better come up with something else. Yeah. I can almost hear somebody, well, Martha, all of them thinkers in them hellfire and brimstone preachers left. That boy. Yeah, there's a few of us still around, Bubba, because it's still in the book. I said it's still in the book. I wish I could hear an amen. It's still in the book. We don't go there every Sunday, but it's still in the book. And I'd rather talk about it a few times than to live there for eternity. Whew. Wow. As a boy growing up, we used to visit Fredericksburg every once in a while. And it was the worst drive. I don't know, I know I'm dating myself. Most of y'all don't remember. But 17 to Fredericksburg used to be concrete with tar-filled joints. And that old Buick station, chunka, bunka, chunka, 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 chunka. 14 million chunkas later, you arrived at Fredericksburg. Anybody remember that? All four of us. Oh, man, this is depressing. Somebody help me. Oh, well, let me just, any road. How many been on any road, concrete with the expansion tar filled joint? Thank you. When I became pastor here. In fact, I'll give a shout out. It's Miss Jessica. Miss Jessica come to me after service one day and said, Pastor, there's another way to get to Fredericksburg. I said, there is. Tell me more. Tell me something good. And she proceeded to tell me how to bypass about 12 to 14 stoplights, swing down through Poplar Branch and Poplar is Poplar Branch. Yeah. Poplar Road. Poplar, anyway, it's something over there. And then you get to Enon and you get to Truslow. Anyway, I'm like, wow. But suppose instead of that, I just said, Jessica, I already know how to get to Fredericksburg. I thank you very much. And I just keep chunka, 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 chunka. 14 lights later, I'm here because I'm too proud to change what I've done. Say it with me. All my life. Have you ever noticed how when you're talking to somebody and they say, well, all my life, it's almost like once they say all my life, that means that's the authority. This is the end of the discussion. We're not even going to debate this because all my life. You know, there's still an organization called the Flat Earth Society. They actually have members. Last time I checked and read about, I think they had like 2,300 members. I hope it's all just tongue in cheek. But I kind of have a feeling as crazy as the world is, it probably isn't for some. Flat Earth Society. Forget all the pictures from NASA. Forget all the pictures of outer space. Forget Isaiah that you can read where it says, he that sits upon the circle of the earth. Forget all that. I'm a member, card-carrying member of the Flat Earth Society. All my life. Wow. You know, if crazy is a disease, I don't want to catch it. Come on, somebody. Jesus, please. Vaccinate me with your wisdom. Vaccinate me with your Holy Ghost. How many don't want to catch crazy? Come on, somebody. I mean, it's everywhere. So if it's contagious, we're in trouble. Let's just pray, plead the blood. And, you know, if you need to take a test right now, they say 1 out of 4 people is mentally deranged. So look at 3 of your closest friends. If they're normal, it's you. So, yeah, never mind. Let me move on. Yeah, yeah. Y'all already running the math and looking at one another. Yeah. Okay. Wow. So, yeah. So to do this, can I just tell you this real quick? And I'm almost there, okay? But to do this about a road or the earth or whatever else you may have brought into that thing that just isn't true, that's one thing. But if you believe the wrong thing about eternity, salvation, heaven and hell, what if the lies you're holding on to are keeping you from the truth that would have made you free? What if your refusal to adjust your beliefs or even entertain the idea that you may be wrong is viewed by God as rebellion and pride? And in the end, you'll be kept out of heaven because you wouldn't change your course. You know, it's been said knowledge is power, and it's true, but wrong knowledge can be a destructive force as well that damns your soul. Wrong information can not only lead you down a wrong road, but lead you down a wrong path that costs you your eternal soul. Hosea writes, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee, that thou shalt be no priest to me. Seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children." In Mark 4:24, Jesus says, "Take heed what you hear. With what measure you meet, it shall be measured you, and unto you that hear shall more be given." Mark 13:33 says, "Take ye heed, watch and pray, for you know not when the time is," speaking of the end times. In Luke 8, he says, "Take heed, therefore, how you hear. For whosoever hath, to him shall be given, and whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken, even that which he seems to have." In Luke 11, "Take heed, therefore, that the light which is in thee be not darkness." Luke 21, "And take heed yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeit and drunkenness and cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unawares. Watch ye therefore," I'm going off script now, "but watch ye therefore and pray always that you may be accounted worthy to escape these things that are coming to pass and stand before the Son of Man." How many know we're at the end of time? This solar eclipse coming up on April 8th, it has all kinds of prophetic connotations. You run these dates and years. We're going to get into that a little bit tonight. If you want to come, it'll be fascinating. We'll get into that a little bit. And I'm not putting any date out. Please don't go out here. "Pastor said Jesus is coming April 8th. I never said that. Don't you do that. God will judge you for lying. You not putting no date on me, Bubba. I'm telling you be ready. I'm telling you, get your head out the proverbial sand. Don't live like an ostrich. Get your head looking up. Lift up your eyes. For your redemption draws nigh. And that's what Jesus said. When you see these things begin to come to pass, look up. Lift up your heads for your redemption. I'm going to tell you something. House ought to be packed today. Because Jesus is about to come back. And too many are sleeping, run out of oil. And they're in the foolish category. You're here today. We're going to count you wise. How many know wise people? The Bible said the simple pass on and are punished. But the wise see the danger and hide themselves. And how many know there's only one good place to hide yourself from that danger? It's called that old hymn of the church, "Rock of Ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee." Wow. What a Savior. 1 Corinthians 10. Wherefore let him that thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. Hebrews 2. Therefore we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we've heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. Hebrews 3, take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. How many know you can't depart from nothing you were never at? To take heed means to pay close, careful attention. Jesus said, take heed what you hear. Why? Because what you hear shapes your belief system. And you can have your beliefs altered and twisted by listening to lies. How many know we've got a news media today, for the most part, is lying out their teeth. You say, well, how do you know they're lying, Pastor? Just watch the moment their lips start to move. And everything they told you was just a conspiracy has now come true on steroids. And you're still watching them? And you're still watching them? And you're still entertaining and inviting liars into your living room? If faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God, what kind of belief system do you get from listening to lies? And how many know the devil's a liar? And how many know he's trying to damn your soul? And as I said Friday night, he doesn't come to you and say, the following is a paper clip and has them from hell. No, he comes as an angel of light. He comes as a deceptive thing. He comes as something attractive. And the reason it's glowing is because it's so paper thin. When you burst through it, it's the flames of hell. He's a deceiver. He's a liar. You're here today to pull the cover off the boogeyman, so to speak, and look behind the curtain and see what's really going on. Because the truth will make you free. How many know once you get free, you got to stay free? Come on, somebody. And the same thing that made you free keeps you free. It's called truth. You can't be afraid of truth. Truth is your friend. We're coming in for the conclusion. How then shall they call in him in whom they've not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they've not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it's written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But they've not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah said, Lord, who hath believed our report? So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Notice faith comes by hearing, not seeing. And yet all our life, we've heard, well, I won't believe it unless I see it. And yet Jesus says in his word, faith comes by hearing. Wow. And with all the AI stuff, maybe you really can't believe your lying eyes. But you better hear the voice of the Lord. And Jesus said, I'm the good shepherd, and my sheep know my voice, and another they'll not follow. Hallelujah. You know, if I could trust y'all, I would almost buy me a bunch of bells. You know, those old-timey bells that are on the counters where you ding them for service and distribute them out. And when I make a real good point, all you go, ding, 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 ding. But I'm afraid that might rapidly go downhill. I'd have to send somebody out, collect the bells, please, collect them. But I mean, that was a real good place to ring in. Come on, somebody. That was a real good place right there. Wow. So what do you know that just isn't so? It may take some courage to admit it. It may take some humbling to say all my life I've been wrong. But it sure beats being wrong for eternity. Prophets prophesy falsely, the priests bear rule by their means. Jeremiah 5. I'm kind of skipping for time. My people love to have it, so what will you do in the end thereof? Matthew 13, as therefore the tares are gathered to burn in the fire, so shall it be at the end of the world. What was does Jesus' parable about the wheat and the tares? So let them grow together, and at the end they're going to be harvested. What's wheat? Wheat is the truth. Wheat's the good stuff. What's tares? It's chaff. It's something that's no good. It's non-edible. It has, you just, and how did they winnow it? How did they separate it? They would stick their pitchfork into a big pile, throw it up in the air on a windy day, and the light, fluffy chaff would blow away in the wind, and the grain would fall back down to the ground. And you start out this great big fluffy pile like you really got something, and you end up with a little... How many know it ain't all about fluff? Come on, somebody. It ain't all about fluff. It ain't all about fluff. I've been working on my pulpit bumper for that very reason. It ain't all about fluff. Come on, somebody. Help me. Hallelujah. So here we go. We're coming in for a landing. I want you to hear this. Romans 3:23 tells me all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23 tells me the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Romans 10 tells me that if I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in my heart that God has raised him from the dead, I can be saved. For if the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation, for the scripture says, whosoever believes on him shall not be ashamed, for there's no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. Everybody say, all that call. All that call. We don't need to be looking around trying to divide everybody up into groups. Just say, all that call. All that call. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Wow. Aren't you glad for that? So, can I just tell you? Here's another thing that needs to be fixed. I was preaching somewhere, and I was talking about how prayer is verbal communication with God. Jesus taught his disciples to pray, and he said, and when you pray, say. Guy coming to me after the service, he said, Brother Steve, he said, I'm 56 years old. He said, tonight I found out I've never prayed once in my entire life. I've only thought things. I've never opened my mouth. You are not saved if you don't open your mouth. You call on the Lord. You open your mouth, you vocalize, you verbally repent of your sins, you verbally call on Jesus. That's the book. And I have no authority to change it, and you don't either. Now, can I tell you something I do believe? God in his mercy, if you're flat on your back in ICU and you can't speak because there's tubes in your throat and everything, and somebody comes in and gives you the gospel for the first time, and you see it and you seize it, and you say, if you believe that and want to accept Christ, squeeze my hand and pray this prayer with me now in your mind. I believe God in his mercy can take that person and usher them into heaven in his arms. But can I tell you this? You never take an exception and turn it into a rule. So for the rest of us that have a voice that we can talk to everybody about everything, we need to be opening our mouth and speaking to our Savior. And so I want to invite you today. I want to invite you today to call on the Lord. So if every head bowed and every eye closed in reverence to God, I want you to understand I've heard all about the seeker-sensitive stuff. I don't follow that. I try to follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. I know they say don't give altar calls. That's old-fashioned, and people are uncomfortable by that. Whoever said church existed for you to be comfort? But actually, it really does. Church is to try to get you comfortable for eternity. So how many think it makes sense to maybe get uncomfortable here for a few minutes if it's going to make me comfortable for eternity? I mean, that's a huge no-brainer, isn't it? Okay? And I don't ask you to bow your head to me. I don't ask you to close your eyes to me, but just simply in reverence to God, just for this moment, just as when we pray, and you don't have to close your eyes to pray all the time. I understand that. But it's out of a thing of reverence and concentration many times, just to block out everything around you. But I wonder how many in this building today, I want you to listen, because they give altar calls in reverse. And sound booth, you can just play whatever's appropriate. Just go ahead. But I wonder how many in this building today, without hesitation, you could say, Pastor, I have done what you said. I've read those scriptures and I believe them. I've called on the Lord and I've asked him to save me. And I know today I'm saved. I'm ready. And I want to spend the rest of my life ready till he takes me home. And you put your hand up high and say, I know I'm saved. I know I'm there. Hallelujah. Thank God. Thank God. You know, the vast majority of us, but there's those sprinkled throughout this congregation that could not raise their hand. And first of all, I want to thank you for your honesty. And secondly, I want to tell you, nobody's going to come back to your bench and pew and seat and try to drag you to the front. We don't believe in that. We believe in invitations. And so does the Holy Spirit. But can I say this, though? The most wisest, awesome thing you could do today would be if you could not raise your hand a moment ago to actually respond to what's getting ready to happen. Because it means you're wise enough, it means you're humble enough, it means you're smart enough to change course before it's too late. So I wonder how many in this building right now, you just say, Pastor, I couldn't raise my hand. If I had, it would have been a lie, and I'm not going to lie to you. I couldn't raise my hand. I don't know, but I know I need to. And I know I need to do what the Word of God says. And you didn't make it up. It wasn't your opinion. You read it to me, and I accept it. It's the Word of the Lord. And you lift a hand and say, pray for me. I'm not ready, and I know I need to make a change. And you'd put your hand up where you are right now and just say, pray for me. Would you do that as we wait just a moment? God bless you. God bless you. Somewhere else. Oh, thank God. I'm going to ask everybody in here born again that has loved Jesus, know you're saved. Won't you intensely pray? And many of you are already doing it right now without me even having asked you. But I'm going to ask the rest of you right now, intently right now, quietly, not drawing attention to yourself, but you're interceding right now because there's a whole lot more that need to raise their hand. And maybe you say, well, Pastor, I feel kind of funny because I've come before, but I've drifted and I've just struggled and I keep falling on my face and I just keep backsliding. It just seems to be so difficult. Listen, this is for you too. I'd rather see you come forward 100 times in this direction than to walk out those doors in eternity lost. You know what I tell people? Keep coming till it takes. Keep coming till something changes in your life for all eternity. So one last call. You'll join these precious ones that just raise their hand. You'll say, pray for me, Pastor. I don't have that assurance today, and I need it. God bless you. Somewhere else. God bless you. Thank God. Stand with me. Stand with me. You know, I remember, for you that don't know, my dad built this church as a teenage kid, heathen kid. Not saved yet myself, about 17 years old, 18. I helped build this church. But I remember hearing my dad say, when I designed this sanctuary, he said, I made it amphitheater, so if you get out in that aisle, it's a downhill drag all the way to the altar. It's make it easy for you. I can still almost hear him saying that. It's a downhill drag. But here's what I'm going to do. We're going to pray one more time. And if you raise your hand a moment ago, I'm going to ask you to step out of your seat. Again, be mindful of the change of elevation of the steps. I know I have to keep telling folks that because, you know, you're in this sanctuary for the first time. You can, like, you know, trip a little bit if you're not looking at where you're headed. But I'm going to pray at the count of three. And if you're in the middle, just excuse yourself. People let you out. I'm going to ask everybody to be sensitive. If somebody in your row needs to be out, don't stand there oblivious and somebody's tapping you and you're like, what are they doing? You know, no, they're trying to get out. Okay? But I'm going to pray. And I'm going to invite you here. Because I like what Billy Graham said. He said, everybody Jesus called, he called publicly. And you know, Jesus said, if you're ashamed to confess me before men, I'll be ashamed to confess you before my Father, which is in heaven. I got to give a shout out to Jade and Ivy one more time. He put his whole professional basketball career on the line and didn't care who liked it and told him the truth. And I commend that kind of boldness. Wow. So you're among friends. So there's nothing really to have to take a lot of courage for. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you right now. Those that just raised their hand, Lord, I ask you right now, Holy Ghost, draw them, prompt them, and let them meet me here now in Jesus' name. 1, 2, 3, come on. Come on as we wait just a moment. Go ahead and bring that music up. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We're going to wait just a moment. Come on, you raised your hand. I don't care if it's the first time you're here. Thank you, Lord. Come on. Come on. We're waiting. We're waiting on you. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Come on. Somebody start praising him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, come on. You're not by yourself. Come on. You say, well, Pastor, I didn't raise my hand, but I should have. Yeah, come on. Come on. I'll never forget. I preached at a church many, many years ago. Many, many years ago, up where I used to live. And the next day, guy showed up in my driveway, sitting in his truck. He looked out the window, tears in his eyes, and he said, I should have went forward yesterday. He drove all the way over there to tell me, I should have went forward yesterday. I don't want you to walk out here and say, I should have answered that altar call. Everything the pastor said was right. All my life I've been, and he nailed it, and I didn't do anything. So I'll wait just a moment. Now I know, as is our custom, I have you come down here and we stand and we pray a blessing, but I realize the crowd just don't lend itself to that today. But I'm going to ask you to stretch your hands forward right where you are. Just stretch your hands. Just stretch your hands. We're going to pray. Amen. Thank God. Keep on coming. Y'all step on up a little closer, if you will. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. In fact, brother, if you want to just sit on that front pew, that's fine. Either, however it works for you. I want you to stretch your hand this way. Now listen, we're going to pray out loud because there's folks watching live stream. And I'm not going to contradict what I just did. Okay? I'm going to ask if I can get a brother or two to come stand with this brother. Thank you, Jesus. And my soon-to-be sister right here. And we're going to pray. And I'm going to ask you in the congregation to pray with me, because guess what? You're just being their backup today. Now out loud together. Dear God in heaven, I come to you. Come on, just say it out loud. Forgive me of all my sins. Write my name in your book of life. Thank you, Jesus, for taking my place so I could be with you forever. Thank you, Jesus, for saving my soul, my Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Now, Father, I pray, Lord, all the struggles, all the battles back and forth, Lord, I say, peace be still. And I pray in Jesus' name, in the mighty name of Jesus, break every chain and hindrance out of this life that keeps my brother from walking with you and touch him today like he's never been touched before. And Lord, I thank you for putting a determination down in him. Lord, a desire to be in your house like never before, that he can grow and feed the man that needs to live inside of him. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Lord, we love you. We love you. Come on, give Jesus a big hand of praise. How many know heaven's celebrating right now? I said heaven's celebrating right now. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Let me bless you right where you stand. Stretch your hand this way one more time to me. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and give you peace. Bless your going out, your coming in, your rising up, and your sitting down. I declare what God has blessed cannot be cursed. Therefore, I reverse any spell, incantation, work of darkness spoken over you. I pray it back on the head of the one who tried to send it sevenfold, that they may know and understand there's a power greater. In the name that's above every name, the name of Jesus, Yeshua HaMashiach, the Savior of all the world and the soon coming King, I bless you in that name, and let the church say yes. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. What a day. Thank you, Jesus. God bless you. We love you. Go with God.